parallel parallel to the observed height and shape plane offsets. If it be achieved mathematically by taking by projecting an offset, a 3D object onto a 2D image plane, which is largely free, by projecting each point in a certain projection direction, which is usually perpendicular to the image plane. So we have the image plane here, and then we have a projection in a direction, and we project it in a right angle towards this image plane. And we do this for all the points that we have here. And of course there are variations of it. So for example, this is usually called an orthographic projection, where we look into the direction of the projection, the opposite direction. There are of course others where we do not look straight at the projection area. So this is the shading image modulus. This is the viewing direction here. Here, and that's defined if it is orthographic or oblique. This is something we will not really talk about, and mostly in practice, of course, we use this orthographic projection just on the variation. We'll be talking about the basic things here. Also, a quick minor important note, there are different definitions of this one, orthographic ones, oblique. Also, later when we talk about audiences today, I think very much for the notation from the book, because this is the theory part, of course, and I think it's the least confusing for you when you look at the theory part in the book, and then they use the same notation there, but if you use certain dates and I might use different phrasing for different dates for any conventions, so always be careful when you do that in English context. Like I said, the projection on the left side, which is, I think we're agreeing, represents the cube in 3D, but it's not the most realistic one, because we think about how we see objects when we look, or how we see the feet when we look at humans, we have a certain perspective view on it, that makes sure that, for example, if somebody's something is further away, it feels smaller, whereas here, if you look at the cube on the left side, the back side of the cube has the same size as the front side, because of course, in real life, these sides have the same size, but when we see that in perspective, the one that is further away should actually be smaller, if you really say the same way, but on my hand, I cannot see most of you sitting here, and I'm alone, because you're looking much larger than my head, because you're further away from me, so for me, you appear much smaller. And this is then done by this so-called perspective projection. That's very mathematically, we're not projecting in a certain direction, but we project towards the viewpoint, which of course, in real life, is our eyes, and in computer simulation, is that the camera position. So we have our image plane again here, then we have a viewpoint, and instead of projection direction, we're projecting towards this viewpoint here, which then, of course, results in a situation that if we have a similar triangle here that has the same size as this one, it appears much smaller on the screen, of course, because this projection here is towards this viewpoint. And again, we make this decision, and then it's distinguishing between oblique and oblique. But again, we'll only talk about this next year, that the camera is placed in the center of the image, plane, and then we look here on towards the image plane at the right angle. So this is the case we're going to cover. So the question is, how can you achieve this? How can you calculate this? And like I said, this is, you have already done this in animals, of course, but so far we use the API and the API processing called cookies. Now, what is going on behind the structure screen? All in, which of course is always important to know, not just that something works, but also how something works, because it doesn't work, and you are having it, and it's much easier to keep up with your code, but you know what's going on behind the structure screen call in. So how do we match the 3D world onto a 2D screen? Well, if you think about what we did so far, of course, same kind of stuff probably come up with the idea that this would end up being basically well, the issue again, because what we're doing here is actually transforming vectors from a 3D to a 2D space, or you can see the 2D space, screen and the 2D hub space, a plane in a 3D space, and it's just moving the vectors from this position in the 3D world to the position, to the right position in the 2D world. The question is, of course, what kind of basis we need to make this mapping from the 3D world to the 2D world, which is the image plane, in a way that makes it really a prospectively correct image. So, let's see what we have. We have a 3D scene described in a coordinate system, which we call a workspace. Again, be careful, in a specific API, this might be called differently. Here, I stick to the notation of the book mostly, which describes it as a workspace, which happens in a different way, the space we describe our virtual world with. And we know that we can describe each vector by a linear combination of the base vectors. And now we want to create a 3D image, a 2D projection of a 3D image of that scene on our screen. So we place our image plane somewhere by putting a camera into our scene. So for example, if we're here, and we say we're looking in this direction, and then we have an image plane here, and now we want to know how do these objects look on this image plane if we are looking in that direction, as if we're looking through a graphic window on this scene, if you're really And of course, the way to describe this is, of course, again, the vectors. We use one vector to describe the position of the camera. We call this an eye vector, or sometimes it's called camera vector. And the other thing is the notation of the book, which calls it an eye vector. In this context, sometimes I think it also is a camera vector, because the eye first camera always means that we do that for eyes. And a gaze vector, which specifies, of course, the direction of the camera, because it's my location, because we don't know where we're looking at or where we're pointing the camera. So we also need to identify one direction, which is done by the gaze vector. And then we have two other parameters, which implicitly also influence what we're seeing. And that is, of course, the distance of the viewing plane from the camera. So that is much stronger than the space here. The distance, let's call it E, and then let's write the distance here from the camera, and also the field of view of the camera, which is, of course, depends also on the distance. If you make this view is wider, so the field of view is basically range that is covered by the camera, and you see here by those parameters, the size of the image plane, the title parameters, the size of the image plane, which is indirectly specified by the distance and the field of view of the camera, they influence what part of the scene we see. So if we have objects here, of course we don't see them, so when we do the calculation of the projection, we only have to consider objects that are within this range, which is why we specify this range in a specific way. We call this range actually the view frustum, and it is of course defined by this limiting side plane that we have on the left side of the plane, that is called sometimes L, the right side of the plane R, which is identified by the field of view of the camera, so we have here the field of view, and then of course that's implicitly defined left and right plane. It also is, of course, something to illustrate it easier, but if you look at the from the side of the field, we also have, of course, a restriction at the top and at the bottom. So this is the kind of code or pyramid that you can see in our camera, but you also see here we have two limitations, which are two planes that bounce this field for us, which are called N and F, which are for near and far plane, at least for that dish. Of course, in front of you, you could say that you could model everything, but there are now problems that you have. So the ones in this screen, you might not want to model objects that are in front of the screen. Also, you might run into position problems, you have positions too close, which is why we strip our view frustum to the front of the view plane. For the distance, you cannot, well, of course, I want to see everything that's here, but of course, you cannot calculate with infinite numbers, so you have to make a restriction. Also, it's kind of logical, if you have an object that is very, very far away, you cannot see it anymore, so it is also from the calculation point of view. We strip also the distance, and we do this by so-called far plane. And that then defines this sort of cut off pyramid that you see here indicated in gray, that is called the view frustum, that contains all the objects that we can draw, and we will see on the screen the perspective projection. And for today, we're restricting ourselves to wireframe models, so we'll not look into the color, we'll just look into the vectors that represent, for example, the triangle on the domestic offset and reject them. And we can collect them at a wide frame model we look into trading and rationalization. In the later lecture, let us say that we're covering later lecture spaces like this here, where objects are partly outside of the field class, so we'll only look into outside and say they're inside of the field class because those are partly outside of it. That's the special treatment, so we'll cover this in the later lecture also. So we have to apply our camera space, we have our camera position, our wheel space, and our field class, we'll distinguish the camera, and we'll choose the projection. If we do that, of course, it would be much easier if the camera would not be at the arbitrary position, but if it would be at the origin. So for example, if you see here, if the camera is at the origin, we're looking in the such direction, then the plane equation becomes minus n for the top front of the field class, and for the near for the far plane, it becomes minus s. So the pendulum obviously makes our calculation much easier. And of course, what we do is, what we can do is we can just transform it by multiplying it with the matrix and then transform it to transform the origin of our coordinates to the position of the camera, and then we say transform the wheel space into the camera space, and we can do this with matrix multiplication, and we'll see the correct matrix later. So this will make our calculation much easier, and then we want to do the perspective projection, and that is, of course, a very complex and difficult step. It would be much easier if we could choose an orthographic projection, which is the orthographic projection. If we have a point x, y, z here, then of course, the orthographic projection of that is just the point x, y. Because we're just ignoring the third coordinate. So that is a very simple calculation. The calculation is just throwing away the coordinates. But this matching here, from x, y, z to the point x, call it x, s, y, s, because it's the x, s, y value on the screen, they are much more complicated. And of course, the solution you're already seeing here by this exact error that I have here, the solution we're doing is, we're not calculating this projection, but using the matrix multiplication to transform the object in our field system into, in a way that is, in an area that is bounded by axis parallel sizes, and that allows us to do orthographic projection. And this transformation here has to be done in a way that it preserves the relative size and the relative distance between objects in a way that the orthographic projection here produces exactly the same result as the perspective projection here. So if you look at this point here, it is projected towards this point on the screen. So we need to transform this point here to another point here that produces the orthographic projection results in the very same point. And if we can do that, then of course we have a very easy case of the projection. Physical step will of course be this one here. So when we have that, then of course we can make our calculation easier by saying, oh, let's just put the values between 0 minus 1 and 1. That will make our calculation easier. So we do it from this reference space. We call this what is the so-called orthographic view volume, in contrast to the first one, the first orthographic view volume has the relation of the size of the surface in a way that we can do the orthographic projection, and that to make the calculation easier, we can transform this. So called canonical view volume is what helps, so because the value is obviously minus 1 and 1. And then, of course, we can easily do the projection, which makes just throwing away the circle coordinates, the circle coordinates, much larger. We can then, of course, have that looking minus 1 and 1. So we also need to do that mapping to the actual window or screen that we want to display on. So, for example, we have a 800 pixel screen or window that we want to show our screen in. Then we just have to do this transformation, which is basically the window scaling. In fact, we can do all of that with matrix multiplication, which is of course one of the reasons why this matrix is much more important in graphics. There is only one step, which is a little more difficult, it's actually quite more difficult, because we need to introduce a new extension of matrix multiplication of the geometry coordinates. But everything else is actually something that we could do already, which we learned in the lecture about matrix transformation. So we have here a step that we can break down this new step in a lot of single matrix multiplications that can later be combined into one matrix and then optimization matrix. But because we have this single step here, we call this the graphics pipeline, which is the essence of the graphics pipeline, and there are extensions with like shading and all the other stuff that we use here. And it's now just why we have this reminder slide from the very first lecture, which is the almost graphics pipeline. So, yeah, so like I said, every